William Morrow and Harper Audio present Death on the Nile, an Hercule Poirot mystery by Agatha Christie, performed by Kenneth Branagh. To Sybil Burnett, who also loves wandering about the world. Author's Foreword. Death on the Nile was written after coming back from a winter in Egypt. When I read it now, I feel myself back again on the steamer from Aswan to Wadi Halfa. There were quite a number of passengers on board, but the ones in this book travelled in my mind and became increasingly real to me in the setting of a Nile steamer. The book has a lot of characters and a very elaborately worked out plot. I think the central situation is intriguing and has dramatic possibilities, and the three characters, Simon, Lynette and Jacqueline, seem to me to be real and alive. My friend, Francis L. Sullivan, liked the book so much that he kept urging me to adapt it for the stage, which in the end I did. I think, myself, that the book is one of the best of my foreign travel ones. And if detective stories are escape literature, and why shouldn't they be, the reader can escape to sunny skies and blue water, as well as to crime, in the confines of an armchair. Agatha Christie. Part 1. Characters in order of their appearance. 1.
Lynette Ridgway. That's her, said Mr. Burnaby, the landlord of the Three Crowns. He nudged his companion. The two men stared with round bucolic eyes and slightly open mouths. A big scarlet Rolls Royce had just stopped in front of the local post office. A girl jumped out, a girl without a hat and wearing a frock that looked, but only looked, simple. A girl with golden hair and straight autocratic features. A girl with a lovely shape, a girl such as was seldom seen in Malton under Woad. With a quick, imperative step, she passed into the post office. That's her, said Mr. Burnaby again, and he went on in a low, awed voice. Millions she's got. Gonna spend thousands on the place. Swimming pools there's gonna be, and Italian gardens, and a ballroom, and half of the house pulled down and rebuilt.
Well, she'll bring money into the town, said his friend. He was a lean, seedy-looking man. His tone was envious and grudging. Mr. Burnaby agreed.
Yes, it's a great thing for Malton under Woad. A great thing it is.
Mr. Burnaby was complacent about it.
Wake us all up proper, he added.
A bit of difference from Sir George, said the other.
Ah, it was the horses did for him, said Mr. Burnaby indulgently. Never had no luck.
What did he get for the place?
A cool 60,000, so I've heard.
The lean man whistled.
Mr. Burnaby went on triumphantly. And they say she'll have spent another 60,000 before she's finished.
Wicked, said the lean man.
Where'd she get all that money from?
America, so I've heard.
Her mother was the only daughter of one of those millionaire blokes.
It's quite like the picture, isn't it? The girl came out of the post office and climbed into the car. As she drove off, the lean man followed her with his eyes. He muttered, it seems all wrong to me, her looking like that. Money and looks. It's too much. If a girl's as rich as that, she's no right to be a good looker as well. And she is a good looker. Got everything that girl has. Doesn't seem fair.
2. Extract from the social column of the Daily Blag. Among those supping at Chematont, I noticed beautiful Lynette Ridgway. She was with the Honourable Joanna Southwood, Lord Windlesham, and Mr. Toby Bryce. Miss Ridgway, as everyone knows, is the daughter of Mellish Ridgway, who married Anna Hartz. She inherits from her grandfather, Leopold Hartz, an immense fortune. The lovely Lynette is the sensation of the moment, and it is rumoured that an engagement may be announced shortly. Certainly, Lord Windlesham seemed very
épris.
3. The Honourable Joanna Southwood said,
"Darling, I think it's going to be all perfectly marvellous."
She was sitting in Lynette Ridgway's bedroom at Woad Hall. From the window, the eye passed over the gardens to open country with blue shadows of woodlands.
"It's rather perfect, isn't it?" said Lynette.
She leaned her arms on the windowsill. Her face was eager, alive, dynamic. Beside her, Joanna Southwood seemed, somehow, a little dim. A tall, thin young woman of 27, with a long, clever face and freakishly plucked eyebrows.
"And you've done so much in the time. Did you have lots of architects and things?"
3.
"What are architects like? I don't think I've ever seen any."
"They were all right. I found them rather unpractical sometimes."
"Darling, you soon put that right. You are the most practical creature."
Joanna picked up a string of pearls from the dressing table.
"I suppose these are real, aren't they, Lynette?"
"Of course."
"Oh, I know it's of course to you, my sweet, but wouldn't be to most people. Heavily cultured or even Woolworth." "Darling, they really are incredible. So exquisitely matched, they must be worth the most fabulous sums."
"Rather vulgar, you think?"
"No, not at all. Just pure beauty."
"What are they worth?"
"About 50,000.
"What a lovely lot of money. Aren't you afraid of having them stolen?"
"No, I always wear them, and anyway, they're insured."
"Let me wear them till dinner time, will you, darling? It would give me such a thrill."
Lynette laughed.
"Of course, if you like."
"Oh, you know, Lynette, I really do envy you. You simply got everything. Here you are at 20, your own mistress, with any amount of money, looks, superb health. You've even got brains. When are you 21?
"Next June, I shall have a grand coming-of-age party in London."
"And then are you going to marry Charles Windlesham? All the dreadful little gossip writers are getting so excited about it, and he really is frightfully devoted."
Lynette shrugged her shoulders.
"I don't know. I don't really want to marry anyone yet."
"Darling, how right you are. It's never quite the same afterwards, is it?"
The telephone shrilled, and Lynette went to it.
"Yes?
Yes?"
The butler's voice answered her. "Mr. Belfour is on the line. Shall I put her through?"
"Belfour? Oh, of course, yes, put her through."
A click and a voice, an eager, soft, slightly breathless voice.
"Hello, is that Miss Ridgway?"
"Lynette! Jackie, darling, I haven't heard anything of you for ages and ages. I know, it's awful, Lynette. I want to see you terribly."
"Darling, can't you come down here? My new toy, I'd love to show it to you."
"That's just what I want to do."
"Well, jump into a train or a car."
"Right, I will. A frightfully dilapidated two-seater. I bought it for £15, and some days it goes beautifully, but it has moods. If I haven't arrived by tea time, you'll know it's had a mood. So long, my sweet."
Lynette replaced the receiver. She crossed back to Joanna.
"That's my oldest friend, Jacqueline de Belfort. We were together at a convent in Paris. She's had the most terribly bad luck. Her father was a French count, her mother was American, a southerner. The father went off with some woman, and her mother lost all her money in the Wall Street crash. Jackie was left absolutely broke. I don't know how she's managed to get along the last 2 years."
Joanna was polishing her deep blood-colored nails with her friend's nail pad. She leant back with her head on one side, scrutinizing the effect.
"Darling," she drawled, "won't that be rather tiresome? If any misfortunes happen to my friends, I always drop them at once. It sounds heartless, but it saves such a lot of trouble later. They always want to borrow money off you, or else they start a dressmaking business and you have to get the most terrible clothes from them. Or they paint lampshades or do batik scarves."
"So if I lost all my money, you'd drop me tomorrow?" "Yes, darling, I would. I mean, you can't say I'm not honest about it. I only like successful people. And you'll find that's true of nearly everybody, only most people won't admit it. They just say that really they can't put up with Mary or Emily or Pamela anymore. Her troubles have made her so bitter and peculiar, poor dear."
"How beastly you are, Joanna."
"I'm only on the make like everyone else."
"I'm not on the make."
"For obvious reasons. You don't have to be sordid when good-looking middle-aged American trustees pay you over a vast allowance every quarter."
"And you're wrong about Jacqueline," said Lynette. "She's not a sponge. I've wanted to help her, but she won't let me. She's as proud as the devil." What's she in such a hurry to see you for?
I'll bet she wants something. You just wait and see.
Well, she sounded excited about something, admitted Lynette. Jackie always did get frightfully worked up over things. She once stuck a penknife into someone.
Darling, how thrilling.
A boy who was teasing a dog. Jackie tried to get him to stop, and he wouldn't. She pulled him and shook him, but he was much stronger than she was. And at last, she whipped out a penknife and plunged it right into him.
There was the most awful row.
I should think so. It sounds most uncomfortable. Lynette's maid entered the room. With a murmured word of apology, she took down a dress from the wardrobe and went out of the room with it.
What's the matter with Marie? Asked Joanna. She's been crying.
Oh, poor thing. You know, I told you she wanted to marry a man who has a job in Egypt. She didn't know much about him, so I thought I'd better make sure he was all right. It turned out that he had a wife already and 3 children.
What a lot of enemies you must make, Lynette.
Enemies? Lynette looked surprised. Joanna nodded and helped herself to a cigarette.
Enemies, my sweet, you're so devastatingly efficient, and you're so frightfully good at doing the right thing.
Lynette laughed.
Why, I haven't got an enemy in the world.
4. Lord Windlesham sat under the cedar tree. His eyes rested on the graceful proportions of Woad Hall. There was nothing to mar its old-world beauty. The new buildings and additions were out of sight round the corner. It was a fair and peaceful sight bathed in the autumn sunshine. Nevertheless, as he gazed, it was no longer Woad Hall that Charles Windlesham saw. Instead, he seemed to see a more imposing Elizabethan mansion, a long sweep of park, a bleaker background. It was his own family seat, Charltonbury, and in the foreground stood a figure, a girl's figure, with bright golden hair and an eager, confident face. Lynette, as mistress of Charltonbury. He felt very hopeful. That refusal of hers had not been at all a definite refusal. It had been little more than a plea for time. Well, he could afford to wait a little. How amazingly suitable the whole thing was. It was certainly advisable that he should marry money, but not such a matter of necessity that he could regard himself as forced to put his own feelings on one side. And he loved Lynette. He would have wanted to marry her even if she had been practically penniless instead of one of the richest girls in England. Only, fortunately, she was one of the richest girls in England. His mind played with attractive plans for the future. The mastership of the Rochdale, perhaps? The restoration of the West Wing? No need to let the Scotch shooting. Charles Windlesham dreamed in the sun.
5.
It was 4 o'clock when the dilapidated little two-seater stopped with a sound of crunching gravel. A girl got out of it, a small, slender creature with a mop of dark hair. She ran up the steps and tugged at the bell. A few minutes later, she was being ushered into the long, stately drawing room, and an ecclesiastical butler was saying with the proper mournful intonation, "Miss de Belfort."
"Lynette? Jackie!"
Windlesham stood a little aside, watching sympathetically as this fiery little creature flung herself open-armed upon Lynette.
"Lord Windlesham, Miss de Belfort, my best friend."
A pretty child, he thought. Not really pretty, but decidedly attractive with her dark curly hair and her enormous eyes. He murmured a few tactful nothings and then managed unobtrusively to leave the two friends together. Jacqueline pounced, in a fashion that Lynette remembered as being characteristic of her.
"Windlesham! Windlesham! That's the man the papers always say you're going to marry! Are you, Lynette? Are you?"
Lynette murmured.
"Perhaps." "Darling, I'm so glad he looks nice."
"Oh, don't make up your mind about it. I haven't made up my own mind yet."
"Course not. Queens always proceed with due deliberation to the choosing of a consort."
"Don't be ridiculous, Jackie."
"But you
are a queen, Lynette. You always were. Sa Majesté la Reine Lynette, Lynette la Blonde, and I am the queen's confidant, the trusted maid of honor.
What nonsense you talk, Jackie, darling.
Where have you been all this time? You just disappear, and you never write. I hate writing letters. Where have I been? Oh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.